as you can see, it's not just taking a shovel and digging a hole and throwing some manure in it. There's a lot involved to establishing a correctly designed and constructed manure pond. I'm going to take a couple of quick questions, but so one quick question, this is probably coming to Steve. Does your lab only test samples for NRCS, or can private consultants send tests to your lab as well?
Answer to that is, unless it's a funded project by the NRCS, no, we cannot.
Okay. Second one that would be, go ahead.
Steve, I mean, there was another question in terms of how much time and how much does it cost to get that done?
Well, how we're set up here is we get funded off the top through headquarters, and our customers, which is the NRCS and the states, do not pay for the service. But I keep costs of what it does cost us. If we run the full index compaction and permeability test, we're around the $1,500 to $2,000 range cost.
And that would be per pond, per manure pond?
That'd be for one sample, one large sample of yeast, one liner, yeah. If we have to run several permeability tests, it could go up and into the 2000s, depending on the soil itself, how many perms we have to run. A permeability test runs us about $300
to $350. Okay. And then this one might be for you, Bill. When a pond liner isn't meeting the standard, what procedures or steps are taken to bring that pond into compliance?
So I have good news and bad news. The good news is that a lot of the cost of a waste storage pond is in the earthwork. So if you have a liner that's not meeting, you know, you've already done, you know, the earthwork that gets it there. I mean, the bad news is that it's difficult to rehabilitate a liner. At that point, you're basically looking at what's the best cost to bring that liner up to standard. You know, is it bringing in and just putting a flexible membrane on top of what you got? You could come in and recompact the clay liner, but that's you're basically going to have to start over, and you know, you'll have to remove all the sludge out and then go in and pull out what you've got, and then because you put clay liners in and lifts, so you'll have to pull out and then recompact or bring clay in from a borrow area and do it that way. There isn't really a quick fix for fixing a liner that doesn't meet standard.
Okay.
But like I said, the good news, you've already paid for the earthwork to get the shape right, so it won't cost as much, the next go around.
Okay. I think we'll take one last question while our attendees are filling out the polls that Leslie's put up. So one of the questions was, if you have an earthen pond that's put in, and then you have alfalfa that's grown in the, on the side, on the berms and so forth, concern about taproots from alfalfa and those penetrating a clay liner and so forth, what's your thoughts on that?
So we run into there's a number of things that can cause problems with an existing liner. You'd be surprised when we go out and look at some liners that haven't been well maintained, some problems that we run into. You know, alfalfa is probably a minor one compared to some other things that I've seen where people have left trees basically growing on their their embankments and causing large holes, or erosion of a liner. You know, there is some, you know, when you have erosion, there is some repair that can be done in those cases. What we do now is we try to put a cover layer over top of the clay liner itself. So you do have, you know, a layer of maybe 6 inches of soil above the liner itself. But if you did have some erosion, or you have something like, you know, some growing vegetation that would cause some voids, that would occur above the actual liner. If it's occurring in the actual liner, you know, then you have to wonder how deep is your liner, and what type of material is your liner made of. Some liners are quite thick. You know, Steve gave you an example of one that was a foot thick. You know, these liners can sometimes be 2 feet thick. So if you had a thicker liner, you know, it might affect you a little bit, but it may not affect you enough that you'd have to go in and do remediation. So it's one of those answers that it kind of depends, and that's one of the reasons that operation and maintenance is really important, and you really don't want to have vegetation growing on your actual liner. That's just not a good thing.
Okay. And for those of you that are still on, there's about 68 of you. Thank you for hanging in here this long. I will be giving my presentation as it relates to installation of geomembrane liners at the beginning of next month's webcast due to time constraints today. So thank everybody for participating. Hope you can sign on next month, February 19th, in the second webcast of the series. And we appreciate your participation today. Thank you.